Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Everyone able to see my screen now?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you. Fine. So today we will start with planning our Hadoop cluster, in the sense what are the best methods and practices to plan our cluster, and also we will discuss on few important configurations. We have few important configuration sites that we need to discuss about, and every time we use it to play with them, in the sense whenever we are adding new nodes or deleting any nodes or we are changing anything to our cluster, we will have a look on these configurations as well. Every time we will touch these configurations. So it's very important to understand those configurations as well. Okay. So the first one is when we need a cluster and how big it should be, right? It's not like every time we can use the same size of a cluster, right? It depends on how much amount of data we are getting as input. So that's what it says. Hadoop can run from a single machine to a few thousands of machines. So a cluster can be of any size. It depends on the amount of data, the amount of incoming data we are using to get. Okay. So that's what it says. Hadoop can run from a single machine to a number of machines. Running on a single node is good for development and testing, but won't get you too far, right? So for example, if I run Hadoop in my single machine, it's like I'm going to test only some amount of data where my machine can handle, but it doesn't add any value to my Hadoop technology itself, right? Because Hadoop itself is used to hold and maintain huge amounts of data. But what if I run Hadoop only in my single machine? It doesn't make any sense. We can just use it to test our code. That's it. I mean, we can see like whether our MapReduce programs or pig programs are running properly or not. But it doesn't actually hold huge amount of data. So that is the reason we say like running on a single node is good for development and testing. That's it. So but whenever you are trying to implement your code or whenever you are trying to launch it on a cluster, we have to go with huge number of machines. Typically, people start with a cluster that has small number of nodes and increase it based on the requirements. So what companies do is whenever they plan to have Hadoop in their company, they will start with a small cluster and they will do a test runs with small amounts of data. If everything goes well and they are getting data as input, which is huge day by day, so depending on the data, they will increase their number of machines in their cluster. So suppose if they have today 10 terabytes as input, they may maintain 10 machines. And tomorrow, if they are expecting 20 to 30 terabytes of data, they will increase their machines. So it all depends on the input. The decision of growing your cluster is most commonly based on the amount of storage capacity required. So that's what it's going to say. Let's see with an example. Okay. Suppose, think like, as of today, we all are as a team and from US, suppose I am getting an input into my cluster which is of 2 terabytes per month. So, okay, I am having a cluster in US and the amount of data it's getting per month is 2 terabytes. Okay. So with default replication factor of 3, 6 terabytes of extra storage is required per month, right? We have a replication factor for whatever the data we are getting, right? So if we have the default replication factor as 3 only, then it will be 6 terabytes, 2 into 3, equal to 6 terabytes of storage is required per month, right? Plus 30% overhead, that is other storage. Not all storage in a server be allocated to HDFS. So now imagine like, I have a machine which can hold 4 terabytes of data. So it's not like I use HDFS only for the whole 4 terabytes of data. I will use some amount of storage for my operating system as well, right? My operating has to my OS has to hold some basic data as well along with the HDFS, right? So I will distribute these 4 terabytes as 3 terabytes for HDFS and 1 terabyte for my operating system. So I will distribute my whole hard disk in that way. So that's what it says. For example, we can treat like plus 30% overhead, that is other storage. So for 6 terabytes, it would be 2 terabytes, right? So totally we need 8 terabytes of extra storage per month, including all the replication factors, all the OS local data and everything. With suppose I have 4 machines which is 1 terabyte hard disk each. So okay, today this is what my input is I have planned, and I thought okay, let's buy 4 machines to form a cluster. So what I will do, I would need 2 machines per month, right? So if you consider for a year it will be 24 data nodes, because for a year it will be 96 terabytes of data that will be coming as input. So I will have 24 data nodes. So this is how I plan number of machines that I need to have in a cluster based on the incoming data. So fine. Okay. So we will see few general guidelines on hardware. Okay. We all know, right? There are 2 types of nodes, that is master nodes and slave nodes. Guys, just let me know like what are the daemons that will be running on master nodes. Let's see what we know till now. Just try it, okay? What are the daemons that runs as master nodes? Name node and job tracker, Arjun is saying. Okay, partially okay. Venkat is telling only name node. Come on thing guys, Arjun is better, he is okay, but still, there is one more daemon. Oops. Right, secondary name node, right. All the 3 will form a master nodes, name node, job tracker and secondary name node. And what are slave nodes? So what are the daemons that will come under slave nodes? Data node and task tracker. Perfect. Arjun is superb. Right. Okay, thank you Rahul. Yeah. So there are 2 types of nodes, that is master node and slave nodes. Master node runs the name node, job tracker and secondary name node, as we all know. In larger deployments, name node runs on a different server, job tracker runs on a different server and secondary name node runs on a different server. So it all depends on the size of your cluster. Suppose you are having a very small cluster, then what you would prefer is run these daemons on a single machine. But what if a case I am having a very big cluster, maybe 200 to 300 machines, then I would prefer each of the daemon run on a single machine. So that's what my configuration would be. So in smaller deployments, name node and job tracker runs on the same node and secondary name node runs on a different server. In some cases in smaller deployment, all the 3 will run on the same machine. In the sense, name node, job tracker and secondary name node runs on a single machine. So it all depends on the size of cluster we are maintaining. Slave node runs data node and task tracker. But at any case or in any deployment way or method, slave node will always have data node and task tracker. So we will see some hardware configurations of our master node, like our name node and job tracker. Okay. Master node are single point of failures, right? Whenever name node goes down, our HDFS is down, right? So we have to do or follow some techniques to get this name node up again, right? So that's what it says. Name node going down will make HDFS inaccessible. So whenever we see that our name node is not working, we can say that HDFS is down at all. And job tracker going down means all the jobs would fail. Right, whenever the job tracker goes down, we will not be able to start any of the task in our data nodes. So in the sense, all the job will not start, or whatever the jobs that were running would fail if job tracker goes down. Avoid using commodity hardware. Use career class hardware. So if you consider for master nodes, don't go for commodity hardware, because we should have high failure management on these master nodes, because they should be in such a way that they will never go down because of any hardware limitations or considerations. So that's the reason, don't use commodity hardware for master nodes. So preferably use career class hardware for name node, job tracker and secondary name node. So our hardware configurations for master nodes should maintain dual power supplies. So for example, if one power goes down, we can work on the others also. And the next one is dual Ethernet cards. So it's always better that whatever the hardware we are using, it should be on dual mode. It should work on dual mode. So if one goes down, we will have a backup. And at least 32 GB RAM. So whenever we are going for a master node or a few daemons that were acting as masters, we should have at least 32 GB RAM. That's the best way we can have. And RAIDed hard drives. In the sense, redundancy, we need to maintain redundancy for master nodes. Okay, so what redundancy means? It will write the data to multiple disks for acting as a backup. So whenever a particular disk will fail, the process of our cluster will not hold. It will continue using the backups. So it's always best to use RAIDed hard drives. So coming to slave node hardware configurations, we have few considerations or hardware configurations that we will follow for slave nodes. So let's see this. Horizontal scaling is better than vertical scaling. That is, a cluster with more nodes will perform better than cluster with few slightly faster nodes. So let's discuss about this point. I have a cluster where my master node, secondary name node and job tracker is running on one single machine, and remaining four machines are acting as a data node. So my cluster is having a size of 5 machines, right? So 4 machines are for data nodes and remaining one is for master node. Suppose I am having an input data of 50 terabytes. Okay, it's always better that I will increase my number of machines to handle this data rather than using best machines for these 4 data nodes to act as a data node on these 4 machines, because anyways, we are having a replication factors and failover managements and so many admin things or admin tasks that will be running internally, such that if any data node goes down, we don't lose our data, right? So it's always better we have hundreds of machines rather than having best few number of machines. So that's what we think for slave nodes. So the typical configuration for slave node would be 1 terabyte for each of the machine, which is having number of hard disks, and 2 quad core CPUs and 24 to 32 GB RAM. So the typical ratio would be like 1:2, in the sense 1 hard drive, 2 cores and 6 to 8 GB RAM for each of the machine. So we will see few other also. Avoid using RAID storage on slave nodes because redundancy is already built in Hadoop, right? We will use RAID storage only for our master nodes because we don't have any replication factor for name nodes or job trackers, because if one goes down, if one service goes down, everything will go down. So that's the reason we use RAID storage for master nodes, whereas we doesn't use the RAID storage for our slave nodes because they already have a built-in mechanism of redundancy. RAM and processor cores are very instrumental in deciding how many simultaneous mappers and reducers should run. So what this says is, like, suppose I have purchased 4 machines, or else, can you go to previous slide? Okay, Rahul, one second. Is this the one? Is this the one you are looking for, Rahul?
Yeah, this is the one I was looking for. Thank you.
Yeah, sure, no problem.
Can you talk about the ratio at the end, the previous slide?
Right, sure.
Thank you.
See, if you see, like, for example, I have one hard drive and it consists of 2 quad core CPUs, then each machine will have 6 to 8 GB RAM. So that's what I have for a slave node configuration. So generally for each of the machine, I would think like it should have at least 6 to 8 GB of RAM. But when you go to master node, you will maintain like 32 GB RAM at least. So that's what we discussed in our previous slide. At least 32 GB RAM should be there. Okay?
But in the slave node slide, you have 24 to 32 GB listed. I don't know if that
That was the configuration I had given for 4 machines. So that's what the first line says. 4 into 1 terabyte or 2 terabytes of hard disk. So I am talking this configuration for 4 machines.
Okay.
Okay?
Alright. Thank you.
Okay. No problem. So you're fine this with this slide, right? Avoid using RAID configurations or RAID storage on slave nodes because redundancy is already built. You're fine with this, right? Okay, let me tell you again. For example, if you consider master nodes in the sense the name node or job tracker, you don't have any redundancy concepts for having the metadata, right? You will just have a backup of the metadata, but you are not storing any redundancy, like whatever the metadata the name node is maintaining have a replication factor of 3 or 4, something like that. We have this replication factor defined only for storing the data, the actual data, right? So that's the reason we use RAID storage for master nodes. So RAID storage means it will have redundancy. So if, for example, I store my metadata at one place, again I will save the same metadata on another disk also for a backup, that's it. But for data nodes, we don't need it because we are already maintaining redundancy. So for example, if one particular data node goes down, there is no problem. I can go to another data node and pick that information, right? So that's the reason we don't use a RAID storage. A normal storage is enough for slave nodes. Okay, so RAM and processor cores are very instrumental in deciding how many simultaneous mappers and reducers can run. So let's take an example. Okay, suppose I have 8 processors. Today I went to market and I bought 8 new machines to form a new cluster. So the typical number of tasks that would be running is 1.5 into number of processor cores. So it would be 1.5 into 8 processors. That means I can run 12 tasks at a single moment. At a single moment of time, I can run 12 tasks simultaneously. So this will let you know like how many tasks I can run simultaneously based on my number of machines. Okay? So before going to network considerations, let me ask you a quick question. I'm just asking these questions because we will be wake up at least for few of the things, to hear few of the things. Okay, question. So can anyone try to answer this question? It's a bit tricky question, but still I'm trying to ask you. Okay. So the question is, why I'm having a backup of name node, right? Every time whenever we use it to copy the metadata, there is a secondary name node to maintain or to act as a backup for this name node. But why it's not the case with job tracker? Because when you come to processing, we have only two processes, right? One is the job tracker and another is task tracker. But there is no backup for this job tracker. Why?
Raji, is it because the job tracker is updated by the task tracker?
No, job tracker is not updated by task tracker. See, if you take job tracker and task tracker, is it master daemon? In the sense, it will act as a which task tracker should which task, right? Suppose I have four tasks to be executed. So what my job tracker will do is, okay, task 1 go to data node 3 or task 2 go to data node 4 and run in that data node. So that's what the job tracker will decide. So whatever the task we have currently in my hand, it will decide like, okay, go to this data node and run your task. Okay, go to this particular data node and run your own task. So it will decide the number of tasks. What task tracker does is, it will do the actual execution. So whatever the actual program that is going to be run, for example, if I run a MapReduce program, that will be executed through my task tracker. But what my job tracker will decide is, okay, there is a program called MapReduce 1. Okay, run it in data node 4. So I had assigned this task for my third data node. So that's what the job tracker will decide. Okay, fine with these two demons. But now let's come back to this question again. Okay, why I'm having a backup of name node? Arjun is saying something. Job tracker is a dummy process to tell name node what needs to be done, but the name node contains the metadata. Job tracker is a process which will let you know like which task needs to be executed on which data node. It contacts the name node only to get that information. So suppose I have a task and it is using this particular information. So what is the best area that I can run this information so that the data would be locally available? So that's what it will check with name node. That's it. But it is like a process assignment task. Job tracker, you can consider it. It will assign the processes, but actual execution will happen in task tracker. Fine, Arjun? Okay, fine. So, okay, no one is going to answer my question. Okay, let me tell you. Is like so the answer is okay. Name node is like, it will deal with data and storage concepts, right? So whatever the data I'm having, I can have a backup of it. So that's the reason I'm having a backup node called a secondary name node. But when it comes to processing, I cannot take the backup of a process, right? It has to run, and whenever it fails, I have to restart that process. There is no other way, like I can store the process outputs somewhere. So that's the reason we don't have a backup for job tracker. Fine, guys? Okay. So let me continue. So here are a few network considerations. So Hadoop is bandwidth intensive in the sense each node will talk to other data nodes or other remaining nodes, right? Name node talks to data nodes. Data nodes send heartbeats at regular intervals to name node saying that I am alive and I am working properly. Task tracker send heartbeats at regular intervals saying I am able to process my particular task. Right. Tell me, Arjun. Go ahead, Arjun. You can type your question. Is it a program inbuilt which can... Right. It is an inbuilt process that will come with... No, it doesn't come with HDFS. HDFS is different and processing is different. See, we have two processors, two core processors that will be installed when we install Hadoop, right? One is for storage, another one is for processing. For storage, the services that would be running at the backend is name node and secondary name node and data node. But when it come to processes, it will run task tracker and job tracker. So these are like inbuilt processors that would be running whenever we install Hadoop and we start up our process. So what do you mean by customization, Arjun? So you want to customize your job tracker? Arjun, can you be a bit more clear so that I can understand? For which, are you talking about any process customization or something like that?
Raji, regarding the job tracker, it's like a basic service which is coming inbuilt with the processing.
Correct.
I mean, HDFC. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I'm thinking just like a program which does its task.
No, no, it is a service. It's not a program. It is a service.
Okay, okay.
So it's an inbuilt service, right?
Okay, okay, thank you. Yeah.
Yep, fine. Arjun, are you okay or do you have any other question? Fine. Okay, no problem. Thank you. So here are few communications. Let's come back. Okay. Task tracker send heartbeats at regular intervals. And data nodes talk to each other when data is ingested into Hadoop cluster. So maybe suppose some amount of data is available only in one data node. So whenever a task is assigned to another data node, it has to get this data from the basic data node, right? So in the sense, even the data nodes have to talk or communicate within each other. So to have this communication, we should have some connection between all the nodes, right? So nodes should be connected to each other at minimum of 1 GB per second speed. At least that is what we have to maintain for the speed. But if there is large amount of intermediate data, then 10 GB per second can also be considered. For example, there is more number of communication or much communication is required because it's a very big cluster and so much of intermediate tasks will happen. So then you can have it again for 10 GB per second. So it's configurable. So the minimum amount of speed is configurable. So coming to other configurations of operating system, okay. So Coming to operating system, we can use anything that we can like, but there are few considerations or there are few things that generally people will follow. Most often in production, RHEL is used on master nodes and CentOS or Ubuntu is used in slave nodes. So why we are using Red Hat or something like that in production? Any guess, guys? Why we are going for a RHEL such as Red Hat or something like that for production, but not for in regular environments? In the sense, developer environments, we won't go for CentOS or Ubuntu, or maybe for slave nodes also in production environments we won't go for CentOS or Ubuntu. Only for master nodes we will be using RHEL. Any reason? Any guess?
Because of enterprise support.
Exactly, perfect. So Red Hat gives you enterprise support. Right, Krishna, it's like enterprise support, not exactly certification support. It will give you enterprise support. So if anything goes down or anything happens to our system, they will help you or they will quickly give you. Maybe they will charge you some money, but they will quickly make your notes up again. So there is nothing that we have to think about them. Okay, but for slave nodes, it's okay, we can go for CentOS or Ubuntu. We don't need to spend more money, or we don't need to keep much amount for slave nodes, because it's configurable and definitely we have some redundancy and all those things. So there is no concept of missing the data. Okay. Choose an operating system that your organization is comfortable administering. So it's up to me, like, whether I decide to work with CentOS or with Ubuntu. Whatever I am comfortable with, I can choose that operating system. As you see, Ubuntu, Fedora, RHEL and CentOS are the most common distributions used. In production, always use Oracle's Java. Hadoop being complex may end up exposing bugs on another Java implementations. So whatever the Java product does that is stable now, go for that one only. So because it will definitely have errorless kit, right? So that what it suppose says. In production, be thoughtful about which version of Java is being. Avoid using latest versions as soon as they were available, because for latest versions, there need to be some bug fixes and all those things. So definitely go for a stable one. Whenever a new version is available, don't directly go or jump for it. So Hadoop. Where to get Hadoop? So the best way is get the Hadoop installation from Apache sites. Other than that, we can use many other distributions also that will be provided by other companies. Like we can have a Cloudera CDH4 distribution or Hortonworks HDP distributions as well for our Hadoop implementation. But tomorrow we are going to discuss like how we have to install Hadoop through our Apache sites. What are the things that we have to consider? What is the procedure to install Hadoop? All those things, okay? So this is one interesting topic again, checking for corruption in HDFS. So there is a command called as FSCK. What FSCK does is, FSCK checks for missing or corrupt data blocks. Unlike system FSCK, does not attempt to repair errors. So suppose, whenever I give a FSCK command, that command will tell you like what is the status of our file system, whether it is healthy or not, or is there anything corrupted or something like that. So in my Hadoop, if I give a command of FSCK, it will tell you all these details. But what happens in general for a typical Linux FSCK? For example, in my Linux box, I didn't install Hadoop and I'm trying to give FSCK command. It will tell you like what are the issues that we are having, and along with that, it will fix that issues also. But when it comes to Hadoop, FSCK will not fix the issues. It will just let you know like the status of our cluster, whether it's healthy or not. If anything is corrupted, it will just let you know like it's corrupted. And we as an admin have to do all those corrections again. So that's what the FSCK command tells you. So the two options we are having to correct these errors in our HDFS is auto delete all the corrupted blocks, or you can manually move them to lost or corrupted folders. That's what the two options we have. So here are few example commands for FSCK. I can give it as Hadoop. Whatever the path I want to check, I can give that path and then the command FSCK. For example, if I want to check particular file, I can give that file. Or maybe some particular block, I can give that block as well. So these are few permutations and combinations. So that's what FSCK is about, which will tell you the status. So the next one is the second command, which is called as DFS admin. So what this command? It is a utility for administrators. So only administrators will work this with this particular command. Only they will play with this command. We as a developer will not mostly use this command. Okay. The first command, Hadoop DFS admin report, is use it to tell like what are the number of slave nodes we have in our cluster and what is the status of each of our data nodes. Suppose I am having 5 data nodes, it will report the statuses of each of the data node, like whether it's healthy and all those statuses it will give. And the second one is Hadoop DFS admin refresh nodes. So let's take an example. Suppose today in my cluster I am having 5 machines and tomorrow I am going to add 2 more new nodes. At that time I don't need to restart my name node. Just a refresh command is enough such that my name node will understand that there are 2 more data nodes that I need to talk with. So I don't need to restart my name node. This command will help to know like what are the new data nodes that were coming up. Okay. So the next concept is about safe mode. So let's see this. This is something important. Okay. Manually set the file system to safe mode. We have two options. Maybe the system may automatically go to safe mode, or whenever needed we can go to safe mode as well. So what is that? Whenever your cluster is up and when you lose certain blocks, maybe something is not working or some data node is not working, definitely that block will not work. I mean, in the sense that block need to be accessed through some other data node, right? So at that moment replication factor will go down, because I am having the block replicated in 3 data nodes. In that one particular data node is down means only we have 2 images of that block, right? Again we have to get one more image of that block so that I keep my replication factor again back to 3. So that's what it says about. So whenever a data node goes down, my system will automatically go to safe mode. What safe mode says is it will work only with minimum features. Like I can only read whatever that is available in my cluster. I cannot add new files or something to my cluster when it is in safe mode. So that's what it says. Read only. No changes can be made to my metadata. So no insertions or deletions can happen to my HDFS. Only I can access. That's it. Does not replicate or delete block. Okay. Leaves name node when the configured minimum percentage of blocks satisfy the minimum replication condition. So whenever my replication factor goes to 2, I will add something to my new data node such that those blocks will again get replicated and I will have that replication factor as 3. So then only my system will come out of this safe node. So the one of the way when I enter into safe mode is, for example, I want to upgrade my Hadoop version or something. I have to take my backup of my name node manually. Instead of going to secondary name node, I want to take it manually. So at that mode, what I will do is I will manually go to safe mode and I will do all these operations because nothing can affect my system. So again, when I come back, I have to leave my safe mode such that I can continue my operations. So that's what it says about. And the next one is saves the name node metadata to disk and resets the edit log. Must be in safe node. What it will take is like the secondary name node takes the backup of the name node. But what if I manually want to take the backup? So if I something want to take the manual backup, then I will use this command. So whenever a Hadoop is installed in your cluster, don't try these commands, okay? Because it may affect something. Only the admin can set those things again, because we as a developer don't need to think about this namespace and all those things. Just formatting once the name node is enough. And that is the only command that needs to be given only once our Hadoop is installed, okay? So adding nodes to the cluster. Add the names of the nodes to the include files if you are using this method to explicitly list allowed nodes. Okay, update your rack awareness script with the new information. And the second time, so whenever a data node is added, I have to update my racks. Like in this particular rack, I have added this new node, right? The next one is update the name node with this new information. Right, again this data node is come up and it's going to have these blocks and all those things, blah 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 information. Start the new data node and task tracker instances and restart the job tracker. Check that the new data node and task trackers appear in the web UI. Don't worry about the last point, I will show you tomorrow, like whenever a Hadoop cluster is up and few of the tasks or nodes are up, how it will appear in web UI. Okay, let's discuss something on this. This is a concept which we already discussed. Let us see like how many will answer this question, okay? Right, I can just restart it. I mean, there is nothing to restart. Start. I can just refresh the notes. Okay. So let's see what it says. Okay. So this is what the typical configuration as of today. Just imagine, okay, I have 5 data nodes and these 5 data nodes are going to store 80 GB of data. So each data node is distributed with 16 GB such that it will make up to 80 GB, right? Okay, now so this is what typically happens, because today I am having 16 GB and 5 new nodes were added. Okay, those 5 new nodes are empty as of now. And tomorrow again I am getting new amount of data. That is again 80 GB of data is coming as input. So what my Hadoop cluster will do is, it will add 8 GB of data to each of the data node. So it will start from machine 1 again. Just because new nodes are added does not mean Hadoop will give more data. So this is what defaultly it will happen. So every time when I get new data, it will start adding the data from data node 1 again to till the last data node. So anytime in our cluster, the first data nodes will have huge amount of data, right? So maybe again day after tomorrow I am going to get again some 100 GB of data. Then what I will do is, again my Hadoop cluster will default add 10 GB of data for every data node again. Perfect. Akshay, he's superb. Akshay, you are good, superb. So this is the reason we use balancer. We have to balance cluster after adding nodes. Right, Rahul, right. Very good, guys. It's amazing, right? So that is the reason we will go for balancer. So anytime we are getting huge amount of data to earlier nodes only, so how I have to distribute this data? So that's the reason I use a balancer, and I will give 16 nodes each for each of the system. So once I give a balancer command, it will have again 8 GB plus 8 GB plus, so on. so forth. So that is how it happens whenever we try to add new nodes. Whenever a new node is added and some data came into picture, definitely we have to use a balancer command. So that is what the important thing we have to take care of whenever we are adding nodes. Okay. The second thing is removing nodes from the cluster. Okay, we had seen the addition of nodes and the removing of nodes. Of course, it's an easy task, but what we have to follow the steps is add the names of the nodes to the exclude files, update the name node with the new set of data nodes. So we have to refresh it again such that it will allow these nodes not to connect with our name node, and the name node UI will show the admin stage changing to decommission in process. So don't worry about this user interface. Tomorrow I will show you all those interfaces, how the web interfaces look like. Okay, when all data node report their status decommission, all the blocks will have to be replicated elsewhere. So anyhow, at any time we have to maintain the replication factor. So whenever we remove the data nodes, in the sense whenever we remove some blocks from these nodes, we have to again maintain this replication factor. So we will have this replication in another data node. Shut down the decommissioned nodes, remove the nodes from include and exclude files, and update the name node. So that's what for today, guys. Tomorrow we will see the installation process and what are the types of configuration files, important configuration files that we need to understand, and definitely people will play with those few configuration files. Okay, so we will have a look on the configuration process and the configuration sites as well, and day after tomorrow we will work on few HDFS commands, what each command will do, how to load the data into HDFS, how to write some data or how to read some data from HDFS and all those things. So we'll have some hands-on day after tomorrow. Fine, guys. Any questions? When we will install Hadoop? Are we installing Hadoop on our PC? Yes, Akshay, tomorrow we are going to install Hadoop. We will see the procedure on how to install the Hadoop. I will show you that steps and I will share you that document so that you can follow the same procedure to install Hadoop on your systems. Okay. So any other questions, guys? Fine, guys. Thank you all for joining. So let's meet at this. There is a chance I might be joining class late tomorrow. You will be emailing still. Right, Rahul. No problem. I will be giving those documents. I will be sharing with you all so that you can follow the same steps. But guys, remember that installing Hadoop is definitely a rigorous process. It's not a simple process that we can install Hadoop. It will take a lot of time. So be patient enough to install that. The reason why I am telling you to install by yourself is you will get to know many other things while installing. Don't worry, Rahul, I will be mailing those installation instructions. Fine, guys, let's wind up today's session. Let's meet at the same time tomorrow. We will discuss the installation and what are the installation different modes and what are the important configuration sites. Okay? Thank you all for joining. Have a good night.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.